Hey folks, it's Frithgar here, how you doing? Right, we have finished doing the silage on these three fields here, and then I took everything up to the top field, up to field one, so that is ready to carry on. So we're going to do a bit more of that today and tomorrow, but I don't think we'll be doing much more after that. What I'm going to do first, though, is I'm going to start planting, and this time we're going to make sure that we actually do the oilseed radish properly, which we didn't do last time. We don't have a great deal of fertilizer left over here, so that is going to be one little issue. Let me just open up the tank. We're going to need to buy more fertilizer and bring it back over here fairly soon. How soon? I'm not sure, but yeah, okay. We're going to need to bring it back very, very soon because we have just run out. We've got a little tiny bit left on the conveyor belt, but that's it. And we've got a small heap of seed. The seed is a little bit better, but it's still not ideal. And I'm trying to steer now with my steering wheel, and it's extremely sensitive, and it's sort of twisting the back end around ever so slightly. We can put plenty of seed in here. I think seed actually goes up to, is it 4,000? I think you get 4,000 seed in here. It may even be more than that. So we've got lots of seed in. We'll plant oilseed radish, and then hopefully it'll all work as it should, and we won't need to do any extra fertilization. What we're going to do is we'll do oilseed radish and with fertilizer, and then we'll plant the next crop with fertilizer, and we shouldn't need to do anything else if it all goes well. So my question that I asked you all last week was, well, quite frankly, it was a mistake. I accidentally asked you a question that I'd already asked you several weeks previously, and a few people did pick up on this. I sincerely apologise for this. It was a mistake on my part. I thought that I'd asked that question on Sosnyovka. I didn't ask it on this one. I went back and checked afterwards. And I was asking you if you wanted me to use an auto-load trailer. Right, I'm just going to use the hired help to just do one pass along the bottom, and then we'll go up to the top. So, yeah. I asked you previously if you wanted me to use auto load or not, and previously you all said yes, so I've asked you again, and 3,052 people answered the question this week, despite the fact that I've already asked you this question. 148 people said no, don't use a logging auto load trailer, and 2,904 people said yes, please do use an auto load logging trailer. So I would say that is fairly unanimous to using the auto-load trailer. There's a very few people have said no, they don't. A few people said in the comments that they would really, really love to see auto-load of any kind coming to console. Now, I can understand that, and I don't think you should lose heart on it, because Giants did put the ground response and the crop destruction mods, they put those to console, so it is possible that if they released it themselves they might do it. So whether it's an auto load that does the bales and pallets or an auto load logging script, I guess, well, with the logging script certainly they would have to work with Mahu on that one, so maybe he would get it officially released through Giants on one of their vehicles. I don't know, but don't give up hope yet. For those of you who are on console, don't give up hope just yet. You may yet get a proper auto load trailer. And if you do, I think that would be absolutely fantastic. I think that everybody should be able to play this game, whatever platform you're on. I don't think you should be limited because of the platform that you're on. Obviously, there are limitations when it comes to console because of the power of the machines and the hardware and everything that you've got on it. It does limit it a little bit. However, I think that you should still be able to sort of get as much enjoyment out of it as possible, and I'm all for console users getting a lot of the mods that we get on PC. But anyway, there we go. That's my weekly question that I've asked you twice. And is it going to let me plant? Oh, yeah, it is. Sometimes it doesn't. If you have a little tiny strip like that, sometimes it doesn't like it and it doesn't let you finish planting. So we'll just go along the top, and then we'll let it start working through the field. I was wondering whether we would plant the poplars up on field one once we've done the silage, but I'm actually thinking, because we're doing forestry next, and doing quite a lot of forestry, I was thinking it might be better if we plant a regular crop up there. So we'll go up and we'll plant the oilseed radishes up there as well. And I was thinking it might actually be better if we do a regular crop this time, and then after we've done the forest room harvested, we'll then go up there and plant the poplars, which would also hopefully give us a bit more time to earn the money that we need in order to buy that New Holland forager that we need to buy. Going to be quite an expensive one to get that. Right, I'm slowly getting used to the extreme sensitivity of the steering. There we go. And we'll stick with this one down through here just in case he decides to... He's stopping here. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Right, see, it's just saying that it's finished its task. So if I pull forward a little bit and then press H... Right, now he's carrying on, doing it as he should. I really do like this Challenger. It does look pretty cool with the whole cobra... is it Python or Cobra? I can't remember now. One or the other, but anyway, yeah, with the artwork that it's got on it. There's a bigger tractor that I would like to get at some point, but I don't know if we'll end up getting it on this series or if we'll get it on the map that we move to next, whichever one that might be. And to be honest, we're going to have to start thinking about what map we move on to next, because this is episode 69. We're going to get to 72 this week, which means that to reach 100 episodes, I said we'd run to 100 episodes, and then we'll see about whether we go any further. I've been getting a few more people asking for a fresh map, because we've been on this one and we've been on Sosnovka. We're moving from Sosnovka. I would like to run this one. Well, we will run this one to at least 100 episodes. But then I think we will start seriously considering moving to a new map after we reach around about 100. Maybe go as far as 105. I'm not quite sure. We'll have to see how it sort of works out. The only thing is what map do I go to next? It's going to be the bigger scale stuff. The American Outback map that I showcased for you, so long as that one has been officially released, will be one of the options. I've had a lot of people requesting that I play on that map, so that will be one of the options. So I'd like you to, today's topic of conversation, I'd like you to suggest maps that you think would be good to move to after this one. They don't have to be based in the US. They could be based anywhere in the world. Obviously, like Sosnovka, we've been in Eastern Europe. We're now moving to New Zealand on that one. So it doesn't matter where in the world. We will take a look at it and I will consider it. I want 5 maps that I will put up for a vote when we're much closer to the date that we leave. Obviously, it's not going to be for quite a while yet. We've got other things that we want to do. So my question this week, now I said to you previously, did you want me to do animals? And I did talk about doing all of the animals on this map. However, I've been getting a lot of comments lately that I've been focusing too much on pigs, because all I've done really on the time-lapse series, I've just focused mainly on pigs. It's all been about pigs, getting grain and everything for them. Sosnovka was all about pigs as well. Mostly we've just been building up our pigs and not doing a lot else. Here we've got some cows and some sheep. So my question this week is, do you want me to get pigs? Because I know that several people have sort of had about enough of pigs for a while. I know in Waitea Valley in New Zealand we won't be doing it. There's no pigs there. You can't get them. But here we've got cattle and we've got sheep. So we've got 43 cows, we've got 41 sheep. So I was going to give you the option, do you want me to buy pigs, or would you rather I didn't get any pigs and instead I concentrated on building up more sheep and more cows? Now obviously if we do that, it's we've got to worry about the grass and that, but it does also mean that we don't have, when we grow our crops, we don't have to worry about keeping any of it back to feed the pigs, anything like that. All we do is we sell it when we get it, and we can hopefully make more money doing it that way. At the moment we don't have any crops in storage. But, that's the question for this week, is do I get pigs or do I just stick with my sheep and my cows? It's your vote, it's your game. Head into the comment section down below, let us know which one you want and why. And of course, don't forget to actually mouse over in the top right-hand corner to cast your vote. Right, I'm going to leave the Challenger going here, and I'm going to head up to field 1, where we're going to continue on with our silage. We have got a huge, great big field still to do. So let me just put the spout out on that one and then unfold the header. There we go. I'm just going to go in cab a second, and it's very simply laid out. I'm sure there must be more. I rode as a passenger once in one of these, but I don't remember. It was a long time ago. So I've never used a forager myself. But I'm... I'm guessing there must be a little bit more to it than this. There seems to be maybe... It seems a bit sparse on the control panel there. Although we do have our phone, by the look of it, plugged in there on the side. It's a nice little touch. So, I'm not quite sure about that. I'm not going to do it in cab. I get so many people say they really don't like in cab stuff that I've sort of basically decided to pretty much not do any in cab material from now on. We're going to stick to outside of the cab just because so many people have made that little request. Now, in order to get down this first one, I think what we're going to do is we're going to do once around the field. But if you take a look over here, I have got two trailers. I went and picked up the dolly. We've only got the single wheel dolly there. I should possibly have bought another one, but or at least another one. But I didn't think we'd need it. We got the regular Krampe trailer and the bigger Krampe trailer. So if I come on to here and unhitch there like that, pull this one forward, the great big one forward like that, and stop. We'll pull our, just the first time round the field, we will hitch on to the back of the forager here and pull the trailer ourselves so that we will get a little way round the field. Right, helper A has completed their task. That means that the challenger has already finished planting that field down there. So we will move that one a little bit later on to another field and start another field. I'm going to bring that round. It is going to hitch in, isn't it? Yes, it does. Right. So bring that one over here. What I will do is I'll put the hired help going to do most of the work down through here. I'll start it off myself. I want to go to the actual machine and then start up. There we go. Run down through here. And I like the speed. I love the fact that this thing goes so quickly. It's brilliant. And when you're using the smaller trailer like this, I say smaller trailer, this is still the biggest standard trailer that you can buy in the game. It fits over the top quite nicely. I did notice that when you're pulling it yourself with a bigger trailer, it does, you get a little bit of clipping, and we also noticed that we got clipping on the sides when we were doing it last week. I think that's just kind of something that we'll have to live with and put up with. So like I said, I've never actually driven one of these. I have worked alongside one plenty, and I did ride a little bit in the cab with one. Actually rode in the cab with it when we were doing a little bit of maize silage. It was just sort of a once up and down the field. And it's quite a hypnotic experience when you're sat in the cab. I've driven a combine. I've done quite a lot of hours on a combine. And I love driving a combine. I've only ever done it for two seasons, actually. It's something I haven't done for over 10 years. And it's something I would like to be able to do again one day. The experience of sitting in a combine and driving up and down the field, it's incredibly hypnotic. And there's just something about it that is very, very rewarding. And it's difficult to describe. And I can only imagine that driving one of these would be much the same. Like I said, I did ride in one when I was working. We were using it, and someone else was going around the field first. I think there were two other people in front of me in the queue, so I hopped up into the forager and just rode with him while he went around the field that first time. It was quite amazing. It's something very satisfying about it. You do have to spend a lot of time watching your trailer behind you. And the funny thing was, this guy was like the foreman of the place that I worked for, and I'm going to say this without saying any names, and if the person involved does watch my videos, then he's probably going to be a little embarrassed about it, but so be it. So the foreman, he drove the forager most of the time, through the spring, sort of from May when we started doing grass silage, he was on the forager, and he was on that all the way through. And then in the summer, he went onto a baler when we weren't using the forager, when it was combining. He went onto a baler. And the boss's son, he drove the biggest combine, and then another guy, he drove the other combine. But the foreman, he didn't get involved with the combining. He went off and he would start doing some planting, and he would do a lot of baling. So while he's off doing that, that's fine, and then on the combine, but he then goes on to doing the drilling. And so he doesn't do the autumn maize silage. And because he's not doing the autumn maize silage, someone else has got to do it. And that's where the boss's son stepped in. And oh my goodness. Now, I don't know about other people, but sometimes people shouldn't necessarily be doing a job. And such was the case with the boss's son on this particular job. He was utterly useless. Now, when we first started doing this, the foreman, he said, when I first started there, the foreman, he said, we always, when we're driving along, we put our tractor with the front wheel of the tractor exactly parallel with the front of the forager. He does the rest. He said that any good forager operator will fill the trailer however it's got to be filled. You know, just adjust the stream of the grass going into the machine, into the trailer, so that it fills it all up properly. And he said any good forager operator will always do that. He said you can't expect the tractor driver to run along at great speed, keeping tight to the front of the forager and at the same time adjusting sideways different ways in order to fill the trailer properly. So he said, you know, to avoid any potential accidents, this is how we would do it. Then the boss's son took over, and he would literally scream into the mic. You could see him in the cab screaming, red in the face, angry and furious, because people were just staying parallel with the front of the forager, saying, and I quote, you can't expect me to you can't expect me to fill your trailer and drive the forager. This is a difficult job to do, and that's why I'm doing it, none of you are doing it. He thought he was, he did think quite highly of himself. Now, I apologise to anybody that is a less experienced operator. Let me go and get that lorry over there a minute. The truck, sorry. Truck, we're in the States. We'll go and get that one and bring it over here. And then I'm going to hitch it onto the trailer, onto the truck, and we'll just start working up and down the field from this side, I think. Right, we'll whiz down here and get that trailer, and then we'll follow the forager up the field. I think we might leave the... Should we leave the trailer where it is? It might be better to leave the trailer where it is. We'll take the trailer and put it up the top end, and then we can unhitch it again. So that it's out the way. When we come back down here, we're going to want to be able to get past. So, let me go up alongside like this. It's going to put a little bit in, and then we'll back up onto here. Pick up this one. So, yes, this person, the boss's son, when he was driving the forager, would literally scream abuse at people if they weren't moving correctly and weren't trying to fill the trailers themselves, because he said that he needed to be looking out the front at all times and he couldn't be expected to look behind him as well as look in front of him. That was the job of the tractor drivers. I didn't work there for very much longer after he started screaming abuse at us like that, because quite frankly I don't think that anybody deserves to be spoken to like that. And it's not the kind of environment that I put myself in if I can help it in any way. I've set the cruise control to 8 miles an hour. That should be right. And so, yes, every time I see a class Jaguar forager working in a field on corn, it always reminds me of this person that I worked for and his son. The person that I worked for, he was okay, but he did kind of let his son get away with just about anything that he wanted, which I kind of felt was part of the reason that he was screaming abuse at his workforce. There's no need to treat your employees like that. Everybody's there to do a job, and screaming at people in such fashion, I don't think is very constructive. I also don't think it's at all pleasant in any way. It's just going to back up out of the way there, and then we can get started on this next one. And in our next episode... We've still got plenty of time, I think. I was just going to say, in our next episode, we're going to do some more compaction of the silage clamp. And I've got a new mod. New to me. It's something that was suggested by a viewer. CSX68, I think. Is it FS15 on top of that? There's lots of letters and numbers. I have mentioned him before. He's quite an active person in the comments section. And he gave me a link to a mod. Didn't tell me what it was, he just gave me this link to the mod, I'll take a look. You're going to be in for a surprise tomorrow. It's very, very different to any other mod that I've ever used, and quite frankly, it made me laugh, so I thought we'd bring it in. Yes, it's not 100% realistic. For those of you who want strict realism, you may be a little bit disappointed tomorrow. However, despite that it's not completely realistic, it's I think that it is believable. I think that it's something that could be done, because I know someone that used to have one of these, and he used to actually drive it around. He didn't use it very much for actual work, but he still had one. So it is possible for people to get these things and use them. But you'll see that tomorrow. I'm not telling you now. If you want to see what it is, you'll have to come back tomorrow and watch tomorrow's video. So you see what I did there? I'm sort of roping you in for another episode. Good like that. Whenever I see a forager working in the field, I'm always reminded of my time working for a contractor. And generally, I had a lot of fun on that job. We did all sorts of jobs that I'd never seen before. Well, I'd never done before, and I'd never done since. It was all big machinery on a very big scale, a lot different to what I'd previously been used to. But quite frankly, the bit where you're getting screamed at because you're doing exactly what you've been told to do from the day that you started, that was kind of the final. That was the final straw for me. That was around the time that I handed in my notice. So if you're an employer, please don't scream abuse at your employees just because you're having a bad day. It's not the done thing. You'll never have a happy workforce like that. Trust me, I've been on the receiving end. I've done both sides. I've been on the employer's side, not me personally, but family members. So I've sort of essentially been part of the employing side of things. And I've also been at the bottom of the food chain, being employed by people. And so I can sort of tell the story from both sides. And yeah, you don't want people screaming abuse at you. You're there to do a job. You know you're there to do a job. And if you've got someone that is not doing their job properly, then there are ways that you go about it without being abusive. I'm sure, I know that, you know, you're working on a farm, lots of people that get upset, there's all sorts of things that can go wrong, and you know, you generally just have a bad day, that sort of thing. But still, I think that there's a time and a place, and there is no time and place for that level of abuse that we used to get there. I've sort of gone on about that long enough, I think. What we got to do now is we've got to get both of these trailers down to the bottom. We've got a proper road train going on here. And now I have, because I did this in my time-lapse, I've actually, in my yesterday's time-lapse, I was using four trailers. And as far as I know, that's not allowed anywhere in the States. You're just not allowed to do four trailers. But you are allowed to do two trailers. I had quite a lot of people tell me. Some people said, oh, you're not allowed to do that. But quite a few other people said, where they are in the States, I think Maryland is one of them, you are actually allowed two trailers like this. You're allowed two Arctic trailers, one on a dolly, so sort of one behind the other. It's not allowed everywhere in the States, I know that much. I'm going to put beacons on, and I'll put flashes on, because we are going to be going slow. But yes, some places in the States you are allowed to do this, and some places in the States you're not. So we're going to say that on this map that we're on, we're allowed to do it. We're in one of those locations in the US where you're allowed to. I don't know if you need a special license, or if you've got to have a special permission or anything like that. But I do know that you are allowed to do this. So that's what we're doing. Someone has also shared me a video to show trucks doing silage in the field. And apparently in the States, it's very common. You see it a lot. And I've seen this video. You have the forager pulling the trailer itself, pulling a huge great big trailer like I just did in the field there. That was actually on the video, which I thought was really cool. It was really good to see that. So what we just did, pulling it around the field ourselves, was, you know, people have done that. I just, it's within the bounds of realism. And like I said, I do try to go for realism, but I'm not necessarily going to have realism all the time. I don't think it's a strict rule we have to follow, because at the end of the day, this is a game. Yes, technically it's a simulator, but I feel it's more of a game than a simulator. I would say that train simulator, where it's absolutely realistic and you've got to plan your routes and everything, you just sit in this tiny cab, and those seem to be the ultra realism. Those are the ones that I don't particularly enjoy playing myself. I don't I don't get a lot out of them. This one is more of a game than it is a simulator, at least in my mind. And so it sort of feels a bit more rewarding to me. There's more to do. Am I making sense? I think I might. I'm hoping I'm making sense. But yeah, so sort of, it's a game and a simulator, both rolled into one, and I don't like to strictly adhere to realism at all times. Well, you know that because I use the auto-load trailers. But yeah, there's other aspects of this game that sort of make it really interesting that aren't going towards realism, and I don't mind stepping away from realism in order to sort of make the experience a bit more enjoyable. Which is partly why we're going to be using this thing tomorrow. It's technically, I suppose, there are some people that would do it, but generally speaking, it's probably not the most realistic mod that I'll be using, but I will be using. I'm only going to use it for one episode, and then I'm going to get rid of it again. So we're just going to lease it and then get rid of it. If I just close that one down, and I'll leave that one there, we're going to try and back this trailer up using the dolly. Leave the dolly on. We'll go to the rear hitch on the Tatra like that, and come up to there. Take the cover off, and now I'm going to attempt to back this one round the corner with the dolly on. It's a lot more difficult, but I'm hoping that we can do it. Now then, I want to go that way. So basically, what you do is when you've got a dolly in the middle, a fifth wheel, you point the back of your tractor or your truck the direction that you want your trailer to go. Now, obviously, I'm sort of getting a little bit of a tight turn on there. You point it in the direction that you want the back of your trailer to go. When you're backing just a regular trailer, you put your vehicle in the opposite direction to what you want the back of your trailer to go. And this one, because it's got the fifth wheel, you've got another pivot point. You change that, and you turn. If you want the back of your trailer to go to the right, then you turn the back of your vehicle to go to the right as well. So we do it like that. Let's see. But it's kind of like that. That's the basic principle of it. But you don't want to be turning sharp. You can't turn anywhere near as sharp as you would when you're using a regular one, because you can't sort of straighten it up very easily. So. There we go. Let's push it right back up there, out of the way, and start tipping. Yeah, so you can't push it. You can't turn as sharp because you've got to follow. You've got to snake behind your dolly that you got on there and follow that one and keep it turning at the right rate in order to straighten it up again. Because if you go too sharp with the dolly, you can't swing your vehicle back round in order to pitch it back on. I've no idea if that makes any sense. It made sense in my head, and it kind of makes sense to me as it's coming out, but I know what I'm technically trying to say, whereas not everybody else might understand exactly what I'm going for there. So, yeah, I hope you understand that. I am going to run this back up to the top field, and we'll do a little bit more silage tomorrow. We've got other things that we want to do. If we don't finish doing the silage this week, I'm going to sort of work on this, and we're going to work on planting and compressing the silage clamp, all that sort of thing, for this week. And that trailer hasn't... I thought I closed that trailer. It's back up there. There we go. And go right to the back. And I love having this camera mod. It means that you... there we go. Now it's slow. You can see the belt pulling back in before the gate actually closes. The camera mod were... I don't know what it's called now. It's one that's on the mod hub, and basically it stops your camera from jumping forward when you sort of pass through a machine or something like that. It's really good for a road train when you're trying to pan around and see the back end of it, which is not very easy when you've got just the regular camera system set up. So this mod is absolutely brilliant. It allows you to pan right the way through things. The other thing that it does, and that's something else that I quite like you can do, is it pans right through the buildings. Your camera actually stays where it is, and you go right through the buildings, so you can see the inside of them. I did this to the farmhouse down the bottom. I was a little bit disappointed, I got to be honest, because there was nothing inside. It was just an empty box with grass growing up through the floor. I was really hoping for a bit of furniture or something inside that house, especially after our hard-working 3 map that we did on the time-lapse, you know, where we could go right into the house and back out again. I thought that was great. But anyway, I am fast running out of time. So my question for this week is, I've been doing a lot of pigs on my other maps. So would you like me to avoid using the pigs on this one? Do you want me to get pigs, yes or no? If you don't want me to get pigs, I'll just concentrate on getting more sheep and more cattle on this map, and we can avoid doing pigs for once, because I know that on my other maps I've been concentrating on pigs a huge amount, done a lot to them, and sort of most of what we've been doing has been geared around the pigs on both those other maps. And some of you, quite frankly, are getting fed up with pigs all the time. So we'll try something a bit different, if you like, and we won't go into pigs on this map. We'll just concentrate on cows and on sheep. So it's your vote, it's your game. Head in the comment section down below, let us know what you want. And of course, don't forget to actually cast your vote up in the top right hand corner. Which way we gotta go? Borager's over there. I actually want to go in here. Excuse me, car, I'm gonna have to just cut in front of you a minute. So I'll start filling this one up in the next episode, and I'm gonna actually try it keeping both trailers on, and we'll see what it's like for loading it up like that. If you've enjoyed this episode, please head down below and give me a like. And if you really enjoyed it, please tell your friends all about me. Get them to come and watch as well. That would be awesome. But until next time, thank you very much for watching. This is Frithgar. Goodbye, and see you later.